All right, take your Bibles this evening and let's turn to the book of Philippians, chapter number 4. Philippians chapter number 4. Well, I appreciate the good singing. That ought to do something for you right there, amen. Philippians chapter number 4. Appreciate everybody being in the place tonight. What a privilege we have to be able to assemble ourselves together with the saints of God. And I would dare say that for those of us that love this place, love what we're doing here this evening, we have learned in the last several weeks just how easy it is to take for granted the grace of God and the provisions that the Lord has made for us inside our life, and hopefully given us a little bit more of a definitive perspective on God's goodness, again, His provisions that He makes for us in our life. And my prayer would be that we would go forward from this place and serve Him with more fervor, more determination inside of our life. And a good service this morning. Appreciate, again, everybody being in attendance this morning. Good service, warm service. Nonetheless, glad to be inside of an air-conditioned building this evening. And that ought to make you shout a little bit more intensely. Amen. Knowing that a swift cool air is going to rush over you here in a little while and cool you back down. Philippians chapter number 4. And I announced this morning, don't always do that, but I announced this morning that we would be preaching on the subject tonight of things to think on. Things to think on. If you're an avid Bible student, you're probably very well aware of the passage that we'll be reading from, of course, tonight, Philippians chapter 4. And we are going to turn our attention to verse number 8. And I love this portion of Scripture. Backing back up, really the whole totality of Philippians 4 is just amazing. Verse number 6, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, we learn that we are to let our requests be made known unto God. And boy, what a blessing that is. Verse number 7, dealing with the peace of God that passes all understanding, which will keep our hearts and minds safe in Christ Jesus. That is that the peace of God guards us inside of Jesus Christ, our relationship as believers with Him. And so we come into our text verse for this evening, verse number 8. The Bible says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. Let's pray together. Our Father, we are thankful for the privilege that we have laying before us this evening in a more normal fashion, something that we're a little bit more accustomed to and which will help steal distractions in our minds wandering. I pray that in a more profound sense that we would pay attention to what thus saith the Lord. Help us to learn not to be idle listeners, but to be effective doers of the Word of God this evening. Help us to receive with meekness the engrafted Word of God, which is able to save our souls. Bless our time together this evening for your glory's sake. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Let me start tonight by simply asking us the broad general question, what is it that God is pleased with in regards to our thought life? What kind of thoughts is God pleased with a child of God having? There's no doubt or discrepancy that all of us as God's children have wrestled from time to time in our experiences with our thought life. This is a very easy place for us to go astray. I think it's so easy because it's very, very common and very, again, very easy to play the part of a hypocrite in regards to our thought life. It's very easy to put on the facade of a genuine, authentic Christian and play the part, to look the part, to dress up and to go through the motions. Yeah, you can sing the songs that we've sung together this evening. You can shout the good hearty amens and glory to God. You can do all kinds of things in a service like this and have your mind convinced on the wrong thing. Have your minds preoccupied with thoughts that are not necessarily pleasing to our God. And so Paul deals with this particular subject here in Philippians chapter 4 as he is going to instruct us through divine inspiration what are the appropriate things that you and I should entertain in our minds. What are the appropriate contents of a believer's thought life? And let's begin this evening in verse number 8 by simply defining the terms that the Bible presents to us. There are 8 of those terms that need to be defined in specific terms for us to better understand what it is the Lord would have us to think on. And first of all, verse number 8, Paul says, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things," here's the first term, "whatsoever things are true." Whatsoever things are true. The word true, aletheos, in the Greek, means something that is not concealed, something that is not cluttered up, something that is the opposite of confused or mixed up. And the idea of what is true here is something that is not hidden, if you will. And so the Bible is going to first instruct us that our thought lives ought to be based on what is actual, what is real, and what is true. Now, just for instance here, what is the opposite of thinking on what is not true? What is it to mean? What does it mean to think about what is not true? Well, here's an example that we've probably all faced at some point in time inside our lives, especially as good Baptist brethren. All right, and so here it is. I come into church and I walk in and I start thinking to myself after, you know, maybe after service has concluded, you've had the prelude to the service, everybody's been going around shaking hands and fellowshipping after service, everybody's, you know, wept and prayed and been encouraged by the message, and everybody's kind of on the departing way out, and again, they're shaking hands and talking, and hey, how's it going, and things of that nature, and after everything's said and done, I begin thinking to myself, you know, Sister Jennifer didn't look at me just right before or after the service. And, you know, I noticed that she shook everybody else's hand, it seemed like, but she didn't shake my hand. And some just seemed off. She seemed excited when she was around everybody else, but she just kind of gave me the stank eye a little bit, you know. And so I start thinking to myself, you know, I wonder what would cause Sister Jennifer to be like that. I know what it probably is. The second Tuesday of last week, I didn't really address her right. She's probably bitter. She's probably got some malice in her. She probably don't like me anymore. She probably don't like the outfit I had on it. You know, she's just kind of a stuck-up person anyway. I really don't like her in the first place. And all of these thoughts start going through my head, and in return, I'm going to start giving her the stink eye back. And I'm going to come into service Wednesday night, and I ain't shaking her hand. If she wants to shake my hand, she can shake my hand, but I ain't going over to shake her hand. And matter of fact, I'm not even going to look at her because I think she's got a problem with me. What have I done? Well, I begin thinking something that's not necessarily true. It's just it's really a figment of my imagination. Us Baptist brethren love to do that, don't we? And to circumvent, you know, well, so-and-so didn't act right today. Well, so-and-so may not feel right today. Amen. And so that's the idea. And Paul says, you want to know what is acceptable and acceptable thought life for the believer? Here it is. We are to make sure that what we are thinking about is truthful, that there's some evidence, some weight to it. The second term, verse number 8, we are to think about things that are honest, simnos in the Greek. It means what is honorable, what is respectable. Now think about this in terms of sincerity and simplicity. Things that are honorable, that is, they're held in high esteem. They're things that are deemed very respectable inside of our society. We are to think about such things. The third term is the word just, dikaios in the Greek. It refers to what is righteous. It's given to us as an adjective describing the nature of the thoughts that we are beginning to think or having already thought of inside of our minds. So the idea of me thinking about what is just means I am thinking righteously, or I am thinking what God has deemed to be the correct kinds of thoughts in my life. Some years ago, when I was a younger Christian, it became the acronym WWJD. AD became very popular. And of course, that stood for what would Jesus do. And I never jumped on that bandwagon, still never have. It leaves a lot in the area of hypotheticals. What would Jesus do? I think we should live as Jesus did, not necessarily as he would. It leaves it up for you to say that I'm doing what I think Jesus would do 2,000 years later in a different society and different culture. No, the Bible says we're to let this mind be in us, which was also in Christ Jesus. We're to live the way that he lived. But we could play off from that a little bit and just play around with an acronym and come up with something that tells us how would Jesus want me to think, right? We should learn what it is that is righteous in the eyes of God. What would God deem to be acceptable for me to think about? The fourth term given to us in verse number 8 is the word pure, hagnos. It means, or refers to rather, what is morally clean. In other words, it's something that is free from sin. And Jesus said this in the Sermon on the Mount. He says, you have heard it said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say unto you that whosoever looks at a woman to lust after her has committed adultery already with her in his heart. What's Jesus in regards to there? He is in regards to you thinking about something that is deemed to be impure, something that is immoral, something that is the opposite of a clean lifestyle. So thoughts of fornication, of drunkenness, debauchery, living a life that is not well-pleasing to God would be forbidden by the fourth term of making sure that we are thinking about what is pure. A fifth term comes to our mind here in verse number 8 by the word lovely. Lovely, prosphilis. This is the only time this actual word is used in the New Testament. And it refers to what is sweet, gracious, or what is well-pleasing to God. We would use it in our modern vernacular by saying something like this. Well, isn't that a lovely flower? Or that was a lovely sunset. I would say a lovely sunrise, but you guys sleep in too late. You've never seen the sunrise. And what is a lovely scenery around us? We might use it in that regards. What we're saying is that is very pleasing to my senses. That is something very beautiful, something very sweet. Possibly we would say maybe that is a lovely young girl or a lovely young man. What is sweet, what is gracious, what is well-pleasing? Paul says we are to think about things that God would say that is very sweet and is very gracious, that is very well-pleasing or beautiful to me. A sixth term inside of verse number 8 is the idea of thinking about things that have a good report, a good report. Again, this is the only time this expression is used inside of the New Testament, and it refers to what is highly regarded. What is highly, not just something that is well regarded, but something that is above par, something that is highly regarded. It refers to the reputation of a thing. We might say it like this: we're to think about, or we're to have such a thought life that breaks the mold. And the idea here is that we think differently than the society around us thinks. Everyone else around us may be thinking this way, but as believers, we're called to think in a different way. Does that make sense? We've all been guilty of this at one time in our life or another, usually through the teenage years. A child grows up 6, 7, 8 years old. They're precious. They're starting to have a little bit of discombobulation about them, but they're still precious. And one day a child goes asleep and wakes up and they're 13 years old and their brain dies and stays dead until somewhere around 19, 20 years old, and then their brain begins to revive again. Hopefully you bring them out of mental arrest. Amen. And sometime through those teenage years, the modern expression is, well, everybody else is doing it. So-and-so does it. My cousin does it. My brother does it. Blah, blah, blah. The usual response of parents is, well, if so-and-so jumped off a cliff, would you do it? To which some teenagers in our modern society would say, absolutely yes. Amen. And so, because they've never been outside, they're too busy playing video games. Amen. And so, here's the idea. It doesn't matter what everybody else is thinking about. It doesn't matter the thoughts that everybody else is entertained by. We are to think differently. We are to think not in regard regard, but in high regard as believers. A seventh term in verse number 8 is the idea of thinking about things that have virtue ascribed to them. This is the word arete. It refers to excellence. Again, are you picking up on the pattern here? God doesn't want us to think very base thoughts as believers. We are not to muse or meditate about things of carnal natures. This isn't supposed to be the focus of our attention. We looked at it a little bit more extensively, I guess, this morning. In the message, Paul said in Colossians 3:2, we are to do what? To set our affection on things above. We are to mind high things, holier things, heavenly things inside of our lives. And so the apostle here says that we are to think about things that have a moral excellence about them. That when you think about somebody that's really living right, those are the kind of thoughts that we are to have on a regular basis. And then the eighth and final term used in verse number 8 is things according to the latter part of verse number 8, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise. The word praise here refers to something that is commendable or praiseworthy. Something that is commendable or praiseworthy. We are to think about things that God might esteem us to congratulate a person about. We are to think about things in a fashion that God would be pleased with what we're thinking about. So really the apostle from the first to the eighth term has really just defined for us that we are to think about things that God would be pleased with. So it really leaves it very open for us in a general aspect where we have to use honesty, we have to use sincerity, and we have to use our genuineness about us. Look here. If you want to play the part of a hypocrite, here's a great way or a great area for you to do it, because you can just kind of say, WWJD, what do I think Jesus would think about in 2020 in Goldsboro, North Carolina? But that's not really the question at all. The question is when we are confronted with the Word of God, a steady overview of the Word of God, what is it that we would deem God being pleased with in regards to our thought life? We have to find the mind of God in our life. We have to be settled on what is true, what is honest, what is just, what is pure, what is lovely, what has a good report or reputation, what has virtue or excellence ascribed to it, and what is praiseworthy in the eyes of God. And if we're going to accomplish that, we are going to have to learn to worship God in what? Spirit and in truth. We are called simply in verse number 8 to think better than a lost world that is resigned to an eternity in hell. Now, the last part of verse number 8, Paul says that if there be any of these things, really the totality of them being combined together, Paul says if these things are present in the content in question, that we are to think on these things. Now, the word think means to take an inventory or to estimate. As believers, we are to take all of these things, if you will, into consideration before we allow ourselves to actively think about any potential subject. We are to take all of these things into consideration. So what happens? You get on the internet and you start searching certain sites, and those sites begin promoting thoughts in your brain. And immediately, as a child of God, you are called to begin asking yourselves the question, is what I am beginning to think about true, honest, just, pure, lovely, good report, virtue, and praise? Are these things ascribed to what's going on right now inside of my mind? And if they are not, then I am to remove myself from the source that is causing me to think those thoughts. You are attracted to a member of the opposite sex, and hopefully that is the case. Somebody say a good hearty amen. And when that happens, you are to make sure that you keep your thoughts in line again with what is true, honest, just, pure, and the rest of those terms that are being used. And if any of those throws a red flag up and we say, these thoughts are not in line with what God would have me to think, if they are not deemed from a scriptural vantage point to be righteous things, if they are not considered to be true and honest and just and pure and lovely, then I am not to allow myself further permission to think on those things. Now for the question this evening, why is it so important to guard ourselves in the area of what we allow ourselves to think about? Why is it so important for me as a child of God to ensure that I think on such things that are in regards to these eight terms used in Philippians chapter 4, verse number 8? Well, I'm glad you asked the question. I'd like to answer that for you together tonight. You got your Bibles handy? We're going to use them. I want you to turn to three different passages through the course of the message tonight, and we'll be finished up here in the next 10 or so minutes. First of all, turning your Bibles to the book of Proverbs, chapter number 24. Proverbs, chapter number 24. Why is my thought life so important? Why should I guard myself in regards to what I think about? Here's the first answer to that question if you're jotting notes down. Number one, because wrong thoughts equal sin. Wrong thoughts equal sin. Proverbs chapter 24 and verse number 9. The thought of foolishness is what? Sin. The thought of foolishness is sin. What does that mean? Well, it means to think on anything less than those things that we've just read about is esteemed wrong in the eyes of God. God says it is in violation to my holy law. Sin is transgression of the law. God says, I have set a law whereby believers are to govern themselves by. And in that law, I have, God says, explicitly stated what is permissible for you to think about. And therefore, when you think about something that violates the principles given to us in God's holy word, we have thus sinned against an almighty God. Now, what does that mean for us? Well, that means that sin is not just held in confines of actually committing an act of fornication or drunkenness or drug usage. Sin is not just telling a lie or being mean-spirited to someone. Sin is not just you actively doing something, but sin can be found in the recesses of your mind where no one else can see what's going on behind the closed doors. If you just simply think the wrong thought, God says the thought of foolishness is sin. If we do not qualify what we think about, we will believe it is okay to think about anything, and therefore we will be believing a lie. God has a standard that tells us what is right or holy or pure in regards to our thought life. You say, preacher, where's the standard at? You're holding it. It is in this book. This book defines for us what is well-pleasing and appropriate to God. I don't need to watch Dr. Phil to figure out what I should be thinking about. I don't need to poll the popular crowds and find out what everybody else is thinking about. I don't care what they talk about in the lunchroom. I don't care what goes on in the break room. God says, as believers, there is a certain thing, a certain qualification that we should go through in order to think about what is permissible in his eyes. Now you're going to see this come to pass here in just a minute, but we find ourselves in what we would consider to be a kind of a catch-22, if you will, because here's the way this thing works. I'm going to think about what I'm participating in, right? I'm going to think about what I'm participating in from time to time. I do a little carpentry work on the side, and if I've ever got a job coming up, I'll kind of consume my thoughts with what's going on in that job, because it's what I'm going to be participating in, and because I'm going to be participating in it, I am constantly thinking about it. You do the same thing. I think about things like that every week here around the church. I'm constantly thinking about the messages that I'm going to preach, and I'll sit down to the dinner table maybe Tuesday evening, and I'll just strike up conversation with my wife, and she'll have to hear the whole message for Wednesday night while we're sitting at the dinner table, because it's what's on my mind, and therefore it's on my mind. I want to talk about it because I'm going to engage myself in it. So here's where I'm trying to get to here this evening. You ever wonder why you're having the thoughts that you're having? Proverbs 16, verse number 3 said, commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. Somebody says, I can't control my thought life. You're a liar. We can control our thought life. God tells us how to control our thought life. I control what I think about by making sure I'm engaging myself in doing the right kinds of things in my life. If we do wrong, we think wrong. It's as simple as that. Here's the reality. If you watch pornography, guess what you think of? If you watch folks on television having adulterous relationships, think about, just answer me, what do you think about? Right? If you're constantly listening to the wrong kinds of music inside of your life, think about what you're thinking about. Right? Well, you do the wrong things and you think the wrong things. It creates a cycle of sorts. Wrong thoughts equal sin. That's why it's so important as a child of God to make sure I am guarding my thought life. Here's number two. Turn also here in the book of Proverbs, back a couple of chapters. Proverbs chapter number 23. Proverbs chapter 23, here's the second answer to the question, why is it so important that I guard my thought life? Number one, because wrong thoughts equal sin. It's not okay for you to have those thoughts, right? It's not okay because you're a teenager. It's not okay because you're an older person. It's not okay because you've been there and done that. It's not okay because you're married. It's not okay because you're raised in a Christian home. It's not okay because you're never going to act on those things. Wrong thoughts equals sin. End of discussion. Number two, our thoughts determine our character. Our thoughts determine our character. Here's the cycle. Here's the catch 22. I do what's wrong, therefore I think what's wrong. I think what's wrong, therefore I do what's wrong. Read it with me. Proverbs chapter 23 and verse number 7. For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Well, what kind of person are you? I'll tell you what kind of person you are. You're the kind of person that you're thinking right now. Your thoughts reveal what kind of person you really are. Right? You want to know what's going on in somebody's mind? Watch the way they behave. Because as a man thinketh in his heart, in his inner person, who he really is, the core of his essence, as that man thinks what's going on in control central, in command central in his life, that is going to come out of him. Jesus said, it's not what goes into a man that defiles him, but it is what comes out of him that defiles him. Why? Because out of the abundance of, watch it, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You do what you do because you are what you are. And what is on the inside, when it gets to a certain level, is going to come out. Our thoughts determine our character. F.C. Cook said that the Hebrew verb here for the word thinketh is only found here in the Old Testament and could be read as such. As he is all along in his heart, he is at last in his actions. Right? So as I am thinking in my heart, I'm eventually going to be doing in my actions. What I think about, eventually I'm going to do. Do you see the cycle? I do what's wrong, therefore I think what's wrong. I think what's wrong, therefore I do what's wrong. Oh, wretched man that I am. Is that not what you're thinking? That's what I'm thinking. Who's going to deliver me from the body of this death? Where's the hope? Where's the help? Here's what Paul said. I thank my God through Jesus Christ my Lord. You say, well, there's no hope. No, 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 you're missing the point. There is a hope. It's just outside of you. It's not in your heart. How many times have you ever heard somebody say, well, God knows my heart. That's not in your favor. That's not in my favor. The Bible says that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Your heart will lie to you. Your heart will lie to you. You better not trust your heart. Jesus didn't say sanctify them through your heart because your heart is truth. He said sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is truth. Everything you believe in the child of God's life ought to be filtered and screened through this book. You say you're narrow-minded. You're tuned into the right station. Amen. Wrong thoughts equal sin. Our thoughts determine our character. If you think about it long enough, you'll probably end up doing it. That's the general concept here. Turn your Bible to one more scripture and we'll be done tonight. Isaiah chapter number 26. Isaiah chapter number 26. Preacher, why is it so important that I guard my thought life? Well, first of all, wrong thoughts equal sin. Secondly, our thoughts determine our character. Number three, here it is. Our thoughts reveal our trust. Our thoughts reveal our trust. Let's say it differently. Our thoughts reveal what we are trusting in. Isaiah 26, verse 3, you know it well. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, watch it now, because he does what? Trusteth in thee. Simply put, you will trust or depend on what you spend your time thinking about. Now, I'm not proposing that if you spend all of your time thinking about the latest video games, that you are trusting in video games to save your soul. That's not at all what I'm proposing here. What I am proposing is that if you spend all of your time thinking about and contemplating your favorite sports team, you are going to be depending on your sports team to bring peace about in your life. And when your sports team doesn't perform at the so desired level, you are going to begin losing your peace. Now, it seems to be really a far stretch, but not in America, it's not. Not in America, it's not. There are more people that worship a ball team that runs up and down a green grassy field than there are folks that worship the true and living God of this Bible. Huh? In fact, listen, there's all kinds of bowls. There's baseball and basketball and golf ball and soccer ball and a bunch of goofballs chasing them everywhere. In fact, I like what Brother Billy Mitchell said. Brother Billy Mitchell said that if you're a pitch a ball off into hell, 9/10 of America jump in after. Yeah, amen. You come to the right church tonight. Amen. You see, and what that is you're trusting in that to provide your peace. If you trust in your health to provide your peace, when your health fades, so does your peace. Is that right? If you trust in the economic status of America and the economics begin to go down, so will your peace. You will lose it. Why? Because your thoughts are going to reveal what you're trusting in to afford your peace. This will become your source of peace. And any such peace that does not find God as its author will be found weak at best and will not last, because all things will come to naught. God alone is a source of true peace. You have a good time with all that other stuff. There's pleasure in sin for a season, and who's to say how long that season will last? But I know a definite point that it will end when your time comes to meet your Maker. So what if you enjoy yourself some 70 years when you have all of eternity to really live? And Paul said this: for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, Paul said, but the things which are not seen are eternal. We better learn to get our hopes off from the things that we see in this life. For the last couple of months have told us anything, it should be that this world is passing away, that the elements will melt away one day with a fervent heat, and our hopes should be built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. There is a correct thought life for the child of God. I said this morning, and I'll close here, I said this morning, that the difference in between a dead person and a fainted person ain't much. They look to be the same. And there's a lot of Christians in our day that are fainting. They're fainting because their hearts are overcharged with everything going on. They're too involved in everything given under the sun. They're pleasure driven. They trust in everything else in this world. I want you to know the only peace and satisfaction that you'll ever find in this world is found in the person of Jesus Christ. Stayed upon Jehovah, hearts are fully blessed. God help us with that tonight. Let's stand for prayer. Father, we thank you for your constant love and grace and mercy that is bestowed continuing in our lives. No truer of a verse was ever pinned down than when the author pinned it down: thy mercies are new every morning. God, we bless your name tonight and thank you for your good gifts that you've extended to us. And I pray, dear Father, that you would equip us to live, to think as we ought to, as becometh saints. God, thank you for this privilege we've had to meet here together tonight. Strengthen our hands to the good work that is laid before us. And may we find resolve to honor you in everything we say and do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.